Hello, and welcome to Digital Artcast, hosted by Gordon Neill. This podcast is proudly sponsored by Procreate, the most advanced painting app ever designed for a mobile device. We'll be discussing the app a little more later in the episode, as well as giving away a free copy. But for now, let's get started.
Hey guys, and welcome back to another episode of Digital Artcast. Another episode has came around this month, and I'm getting to speak to the amazing Darmar, or people may also know him as Darko Markovic. Yay, I got it right.
Hey guys, Darmar here.
We're actually just having a hilarious conversation about, because I just interviewed Darek, and obviously you were saying that you and him are brothers from another mother.
He was born on the left side, I was born on the right, and everybody knows that on the right people are much better than on the left, so yeah, he is, you know, an evil version of me.
Right, I see. Evil
stepbrother. He's a great guy.
Yeah, man.
As we were talking, I met him on ICC this year, in April, mm-hmm. and then we were in Bulgaria, and we were lecturers there, and we hang out a lot. And people were confusing us all the time, which was quite funny, you know.
Yeah.
Every time they thought I was Darek, and it was ridiculous.
Yeah.
But, as I tell him always, I'm a much better looking guy, even though other people don't see it.
I'm sure you'd agree, Darko.
Thank you.
So, a bit of a change for the usual structure in the podcast, because we tend to speak to people who have had, a kind of long career in the industry, or people who have made kind of great strides to work in multiple projects. You know, even Darek, like he says, he's only been a couple of years in the industry, five or six, but he's worked on some massive projects. But you, Darko, are probably one of the first people I've had on who is very fresh-faced to the industry. So, just kind of, foot in the door, kind of just starting out. You spoke about you're working on some big projects, but obviously you're under NDA, so you can't speak about them. I remember back a couple of years back, seeing your stuff on Artstation when you won one of the competitions. And then obviously your stuff so far, it has been incredible to watch. Like you said, only been a couple of years in the industry, your stuff is obviously talked about with people I know, and, I've seen things on Artstation and things you've been publishing for your book. So probably just dive into, where you started, where you got your initial inspiration to get in the industry, and why you started concept art specifically.
Please don't stop. Continue talking about me in a good way. I'm enjoying this.
Well, yeah, man.
The Artstation competition, it was only 1 year ago, if you can imagine that. It was in April.
Yeah.
In April, 1 year ago. Actually, May. I know that because it was ICC. And yeah, I'm a fresh face still because I'm there only for 2 years, even though I was a designer before that, but I wasn't a concept designer. I didn't know what it was.
Right.
And I was a car designer, industrial designer. I have a bachelor in industrial design here in Belgrade, and I have a car design master's that I got from Lamborghini in Milano, Italy. And I was there until 2011, which was a fun period of my life.
Cool.
And I enjoyed it quite a lot. But I was like, I already talked about how I got here, that I lost my job in the industry and that I couldn't stay because of my passport.
Right.
And it's a big problem. It was a big, it's a depressing moment when you can't stand somewhere because of some kind of piece of paper.
And
you don't even realize how big of a thing it is until you see it.
Yeah.
So it was really devastating for me, and I had to move to concept art.
Yeah.
But to be honest, let's talk about the side of the story that other people don't know. As I told myself, I'm not going to tell everything in one interview, but I'm going to share pieces of my life because I don't like talking a lot about my life, as everybody sees that on Facebook. I'm not a guy that talks about my personal life, but
yeah.
I had also, before I became a car designer, people heard that story, the guys that talk with me, and I talked about it. Mm-hmm. But before I became a car designer or concept designer or anything of that, I was a student,
Right, yeah.
And I'm a very passionate guy, and I'm a very stubborn guy, and I talk quite a lot, as everybody can see.
Yeah.
And when I was a student, I was trying to enroll in design.
Yeah.
I wanted to be a designer, you know. And it's I wasn't one of those kids that drew all the time, like most of the people in the industry. And I'm always like, when I listen to them, I'm like, oh my God, I'm not like that. I'm so bad, you know.
Yeah.
But I'm a guy that I used to do a lot of mathematics and stuff like that, and I enjoyed it quite a lot. My father is a mechanical engineer.
Right.
So there is no art in my family. Actually, there is, but that's a different story.
Yeah.
And I was always pursuing some different career, but somewhere around 16 years of age, I started doing 3D.
Right.
I fell in love with 3D. That was my first touch. And I didn't know much about the industry, that there is 2D, 3D, blah, blah, blah. I thought everything was 3D.
Right.
So I was working on a 3D projects and modeling, but I was never a typical 3D modeler. I always liked to model my stuff from the head, which I must say didn't look so good because I didn't have the sense of design, but I loved it.
Right, yeah.
And you know, while I was starting to prepare for the university, my father would always say, don't become a designer, you know, there is no money there. Mm. Become something else. Maybe architecture, because, you know, architecture is not art. It's a little bit mathematics. It's a little bit art.
Yeah.
And I wanted to enroll in the University of Belgrade of Architecture.
Yeah.
And I was preparing for 1 year.
Yeah.
And eventually I didn't enter, and I got, I missed 0.5 points to enter.
Oh, God. Wow.
I was 290, let's say 96 or something like that, and the 95 guy entered.
Oh, shit.
So Destiny put his finger there, and I didn't enter.
Yeah.
And I was devastated then. You know, it was because I was a kid. I had 18 years, and I didn't understand life very much.
Yeah.
And everything that happens, then you're crying about everything mostly.
Yeah.
So I was talking with my father, and my father was like, listen, Darko, you are not going to pause a year. Mm-hmm. That's not going to happen. And yeah. I told him, but I want to enter university. I want to do architecture, blah, blah. And he was like, why don't you go on industrial design, but it's a private university.
Right.
And I was like, I don't want to go there because it's a little bit different here than in the rest of the world. Private universities, you go and you pay for diploma and you finish there.
Right.
So before I even entered, I wanted to apply to the regular university, but they told me that I don't have talent and that I should never do that.
Oh, wow.
Because it's people are, how can I say that in English? People are very conservative, and when they're looking at someone else's work, they're mostly seeing what's on the plate.
Yeah.
But problem is, when you're looking like that, you don't see the other sides of a person. Since I wasn't drawing as a kid, I wasn't a good drawer. And
yeah.
University where I wanted to apply, 200 kids apply, and only 4 are accepted, and they all draw like beasts. I mean, at that point, when you're 18, you draw like beasts.
Yeah.
And I wasn't that good because I never drew before.
Mm.
And they drew the whole life. They went to high schools that had art and everything. I didn't have that, but I had something else. I was a very stubborn person, and I work a lot.
Yeah.
And I have a sense of design. I have a sense of storytelling and stuff like that, but I didn't know how to draw. So when you're drawing a naked woman on that exam, I mean, that doesn't have to do a lot of the design or your design thinking.
Yeah.
And they told me, don't do it. You don't know how to draw. Don't do it. It's not your, you can do it.
Mm-hmm.
Anyhow, I finished at the end on the private university.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to go because my father made me go, and
yeah.
I'm very grateful. And I came there, and I was surrounded by people, mostly 90%, they didn't care about art. They didn't care. They came there because they were paid to come there and to finish everything.
Mm-hmm.
But I got in a competition with a normal university in my head because they rejected me and told me I can't do it. I was like, I'm going to prove you I can do it.
Yeah.
Now watch me how I prove it. So I was working like a machine. I was really working a lot. And till third year, I took every single prize in front of their nose. Every fucking prize. Like, I developed a lot. And I was never stopping. And then actually I got the Lamborghini scholarship.
Oh, wow.
So I was the first person from this part of Europe to get the scholarship.
Wow.
And I went there in 2009. And it was, you know, when a life has a plan for you, but you're not realizing it because you are not really seeing the signs. You're only seeing the plate that we talked about.
Right.
I wasn't seeing the bigger picture, that the life was telling me where to go, and I wasn't listening because everybody was telling me something different. You're not good enough. You shouldn't do that. You shouldn't do this. And I'm always telling people when I meet them or I'm talking with them, I'm never a person who tells them you can't do something. I always tell them, listen, maybe your sketches are not good now, but tomorrow, in 1 week, in 1 month, or eventually, if you work hard, you can come wherever you want.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people were telling me I can't do something.
Yeah.
And I don't like to listen to that. You know, I don't like listening. You can't do that. I'm going to prove you wrong. I'm going to prove you wrong. I'm going to work as a maniac and I'm going to prove you wrong. So yeah, that's a different part of my story.
Yeah.
Before entering the car design and everything, and then the crash that I talked about already. I'm not going to mention it and take your time.
Yeah.
But yeah, I lost the job because of the passport. And then I entered concept art.
Yeah.
And I started designing. I always was a concept designer, to be honest, when I look behind. I was always sketching something that wasn't. It was in the future. It was different. It was from my head. I even in the university, when I'm there, everybody's drawing nature or anything. I'm drawing a spaceship in that nature and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So it was different. And thanks to Artstation, 2016, April, I had my big breakthrough. Mm. And since there, everything started.
Yeah, and then that's been obviously a year ago, and then were you contacted kind of straight after the contest to work in a professional sense, or did you have to keep kind of grinding away at stuff?
I will be honest, no.
Right.
I will be honest, completely no. I wasn't contacted, but I was known. When I came to MCC that year, everybody already knew who I was because they were judges of the competition. It was the first competition. Everybody was talking about it.
Yep.
So I already was known and positioned.
Right.
But I didn't get a job. I didn't get anything for 6 months.
Right.
And I continued to grind and grind. And that's why I started working on a book. Because there was no job and I had to... I'm working a lot, really a lot. And I'm not the person that relaxes a lot.
Right.
So I had to do something with my time. And I was working on the book and I was improving myself.
Mm-hmm.
And then I saw that the book has a big potential and I continued working on it. So after 6 months, I got the first client. And then it started... From there, developing a bit, but I continued nailing the nail all the time, like using the hammer, and eventually it paid off.
Cool. And then I mean, it's a totally interesting story that I never knew about. You know, you getting rejected and going to school, and then obviously getting the scholarship. I mean, it just shows what you can accomplish in a short space of time. I know there was a story I read a while back in Imagine FX about, I think it was at the time, a Polish bank manager who basically worked in a bank, you know, hated his job, and then he left, took all the money he had from his severance package. I think he bought some equipment, you know, like a tablet and a basic computer, and grinded for like a year, and then literally got an interview at Ubisoft, I think a year after, like exactly a year after he left his job at the bank. And I think it's good. It's a good example of people, you know, because which is difficult. I think with Serbia, it might be a different culture, but definitely a school telling a student that they shouldn't do something is quite disheartening. And I think that's a make or break moment for a lot of people that, you know, you could have turned around at that age and been like, oh well, you know, fair enough, I'll just never try. But lucky enough, you know, you're determined that you wanted to succeed. So. It's good,
Well, you need to understand I always say to people, you need to understand the reality of yours. If your reality is bad at the moment, you can't run away by telling yourself it's good.
Yeah.
At that moment, my reality wasn't good. I was on a private university. I was with kids that didn't care much about that.
Yeah.
I had a competition from the other universities. I was bad. I wasn't that good. I was really bad at drawing, to be honest. My lines sucked. Everything sucked.
Yeah.
But I had in my mind what I wanted to do. So from my experience, a lot of people don't have the courage to tell to themselves, I suck.
Yeah.
I suck at the moment. I suck.
Yeah.
I need to improve this. Or they have a different problem, and that's they don't suck in some specific area, but they're slacking in all the other areas, and they don't want to improve them because it's hard. It's hard when you're telling to yourself, I suck, you know. But that's my approach. You have to be very honest with yourself. You can't tell yourself I'm the best, I'm this, even though every artist wants to be the best. But you need to be very rational and say, okay, as I said to myself, this was the latest conversation with myself. Okay, Darko, you suck at characters. You literally suck.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not unachievable. start sketching characters, and it will improve over time. And then I was sketching and sketching and sketching. This sucks, this sucks, this sucks, this sucks. After 2 months, I started something liking. Mm-hmm. And then I posted Spiridon character. I don't know, did you see it?
Yeah. I mean, it's been great that you've got him involved in the project, because obviously, you know, everybody knows Spiridon from, you know, his publishing side. And, you know, he's such a big part of the community. And me and him, obviously, I've had a huge passion together. You work in, you know, we both worked on the Playgrounds magazine. It's been good to see that, because obviously I think it was a surprise for me as well, because I had seen so much vehicle stuff from you. And then as soon as I saw Spiridon, I was like, oh, that's really strange, because I've never seen Darko post a character piece. And it's funny when you design armor, because I think it's quite interesting, because I think armor lends itself to vehicle design as well, because it is kind of hard surface.
Yeah, that's true. But I needed to design the characters, because I put the standard so high for myself that I was like, okay, man, your book can't be without the characters. And I was also asking some people to design the characters, and you know how it goes. Okay, tomorrow, it never happened. Yeah. So I was like, okay, Darko, you are cornered. You don't have anywhere to run. Yeah. You suck at character design. If you don't do it good, your book is going to die. Mm-hmm. Go and grind. Go and draw the characters. And I was like, Spiridon, you want to be in the book? And he was like, of course I want to be in the book. And he asked for a mini bear. And I was like, man, I don't know how to draw animals still, but wait, I'm doing that. That's the next step, because I need that kind of characters in the book. And I was like, your bear will have to wait for. Yeah. But we can do you. And he was like, okay, just do me. And he first thought that he's going to be a girl, you know, with blonde hair. And I was like, no, your face. So, yeah, you know, a lot of setting the goals and setting the bar high and trying to reach it, always a little bit higher than you can reach it, because that's the way you can evolve, from my experience.
Yeah.
And when someone tells you can't do something, it's okay to listen, because a lot of people, let's say 50-50% from my experience, depends on what kind of people you stumble on, but 50% are telling you because they can't do it, right. And 50% are telling you because they see what you have at the moment. But that doesn't mean in 1 year that you will have that. You will evolve.
I mean, totally. Yeah, and it's interesting as well, because when I left my job as an engineer to go back and study art, you know, a lot of the initial interviews with colleges and universities, people told me that, I mean, they didn't say that I couldn't do it. They just said, you know, with your level of talent and, you know, the things we see coming from students from high school, you know, you're not quite matching the level we would expect for you to take a place in this course. And you know, it was disheartening, because at the time I hated my job so much, and I really wanted to leave. Getting a place at university or college was a way for me to escape, and because every time I went to an interview people were telling me no, I was more thinking, you know, I have to go back to my job, you know, oh shit, I can't believe, you know, I'm gonna have to, you know, go back and face those guys, and, you know, and work on a job where, you know, I don't feel like I'm appreciated, I don't feel like I belong. And then it was lucky that one particular lecturer took a chance on me on a starter course. And, you know, 5 years later, you know, I just announced the other day that I got my first job working on a game.
Nice.
Congrats, man. Big steps. But yeah, so I mean, like, you know, I think for even, you know, last year or a couple of months before, I was saying to myself, you know, I hadn't done much since I left, but, you know, people were telling me at my job when I left that I'd be back in 6 months, but, you know, so far I've achieved a diploma in graphic design and in industrial design. I'm about to finish my honours degree in 3D animation. I'm potentially going to study a master's in game design. You know, I've started the podcast, I've networked my ass off, you know, like, even when I go to events now, even though, you know, I've not had a big, you know, industry job, people know who I am. And I've done quite a lot and managed to get myself a job. So I mean, it's like I'm coming from the exact same background. You know, I didn't draw much, and you know, I sucked at certain things, but I worked hard to basically get better. And here we both are. So I mean,
the only thing that needs to be done is work. And I see a lot of people who are saying to themselves that they are working, but they are not working. And that's the big problem, you know.
Yeah,
as we talked, you need to tell to yourself, I suck. I suck all the time, a little bit. I suck. You have to be very rational. A lot of people get confused. You know, the one of those artists, you can see them on the universities. When I studied, we had them a lot. Mm-hmm. That are thinking they are the best in the world, but they're average or below average.
Yeah.
And they have but it's like a protection to them. They're protecting themselves from working more, literally, like, I'm the best, I'm the, you know.
Yeah.
It's okay to think that about yourself, but come on, open internet and compare yourself and you will see where you are, you know.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And again, I think it's because people sometimes live in a bubble where they aren't exposed to the outside world and don't know what is beyond university or school. Because I know, you know, when I'm talking to students from the years below me and stuff like that, and they're doing 3D, I'll say to them, oh yeah, you got any favourite artists that you follow on Artstation or anything that inspires you? And they'll say, well, not really, you know, I like this video game or I like this film. And I'm like, yeah, yeah. And I'm like, oh, well, that's cool, man, yeah, but, you know, do you know who worked on that film? Do you know who was the artist at the time? Who'd done the 3D, who'd done the 2D? And are you an Artstation? And they'll always be like, no. And I'm like, well, you know, you really should look at least and see what, you know, is out there and what people are posting. Yeah, because they're so sheltered, you know, they just think that, you know, the university stuff they do will be enough to get them a job. And
good luck with it.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. I mean,
good luck.
Yeah,
the reality is gonna kick in today or tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, it was the same obviously when I was at my university. I got the chance to go and do an internship at Access Studios in Glasgow, who obviously worked.
Yeah, I saw that, very nice.
Yeah, yeah, and then, like, you know, I was one of few who obviously got the chance to do that, and you know, people, if people could sit in that studio for a day, you know, even just a day, and see the level of enthusiasm from the artists that work there, because everybody is so fucking talented, so driven. You know, and it's the way you need to work if you want to be in that industry, and people at university, you know, just, you know, can't see the comparison of the level they need to reach, which is unfortunate, obviously, because you want everything in the school to do well, you want people to do well, but I think people are very sheltered, so yeah.
That's true.
Yeah. And then obviously, because, you know, you've done your 6 months of grinding, you've worked up, and you know, you know you're working on projects, you know, on the projects, but do you feel that you've had to work harder now that you have work, or is your pace going to stay the same? Or
my pace was always insane. People are always telling me I work too much. It's the way it is, you know.
Yeah.
Because I work a lot. I always worked a lot because I love what I do, and when I chose what I'm working on, I need to love it, because I don't know any other way. I know a lot of people who are very unhappy with their job, which is paid quite good and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I never had that logic. I was like, okay, I will be paid average or good, mm-hmm. but I want to love what I'm doing. I want to love, and I want to do it with pure passion.
Yeah.
And I'm grinding a lot, especially because of the book. Last year I calculate, I'm putting hours because I want to know where I am.
Mm-hmm.
And last year I had average 13 hours when you calculate everything per day, which means I work on weekends also a lot,
right.
But somehow I also work out, and I also from time to time have social life, not every time, but I have social life. But yeah, I'm when you enter the industry, you have, from what I think, that's my, because I'm fresh face.
Yeah.
You need to keep them happy. You need to keep, you're not positioned, and I don't know, it's maybe my personality, it's maybe my thinking, but I always want to push the boundaries, because that's the only way to grow.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh no, totally. I mean, I think pushing outside of your comfort zone is something that you need to enforce. And I mean, like, I mean, I'm kind of saying all this kind of stuff, but I know, you know, I'm very the opposite of you. You know, I mean, I have obviously put work in to a point where, you know, I've qualified, and, you know, I've got some stuff done, and, you know, I've worked in industry in the podcast, but I know I could be doing a lot more, and I think it's always the way you should be pushing yourself to do more, because that's how you grow. That's how you become a better artist. I think, you know, when you stay, you know, you only draw for 2 or 3 hours a day, or you only work on 3D 2 or 3 hours a day, then I think the improvement will come, but it will come a lot slower. So, you know, whereas, you know, within 2 years, you know, you've won this competition, you've got professional work. If you had maybe done 13 hours a day and done 3 hours a day, you would have got a gig, but maybe 6 or 7
that's
years
true.
From now.
That's true.
Yeah.
But you need to understand that also, I don't come from the position that you come. I come from Serbia, and we are isolated. Mm-hmm. And I have a couple of studios here, but they are not they're not bad, but not what I want.
Right.
And I'm always, you know, I always felt like a lower race, even though it sounds like shit when I say it, but like a lower race. So I had to position myself very high.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a teacher from which was he was giving me sketching lessons, and he finished in USA, and he was always like, Darko, if you want to succeed, you need to go to USA, because USA people, that you need only to be 15% better than them to get a job and stuff like that, even though it's impossible for me to go there if only company wants to, but it's really hard process. And if you will go to Europe, you need to be 45%, because we are not European Union, you know, it's the way it is. And we always have it in the back of my mind, and it it makes me a little bit insecure, and that's why I work so much. That's why I work so much. So
I mean, like, and I think there's two sides to that coin, and I definitely think that you know, there's two ways you can go with it. There's the way you've went where your fear, in a way, has made you work harder and pushed harder because you want to then not be in a place like you were years ago where, you know, you lost your job and you had to move home and stuff. You want to always have a means where you can, you know, you can go work where you want. So that's why you work so hard. But then I think there's the opposite side, which is me to an extent and other people I know, where the fear cripples you almost, and you don't want to pursue that life because you're too afraid of failure. You know, you're so afraid that you're going to fail. That you don't even want to start. And, you know, people would always say, you know, to my friends who are not in the industry, they say, oh, you work so hard. But then I've, you know, met industry people who say, oh no, man, you procrastinate too much. And I'm like, yeah, but it's not because I don't want to, not because I'm lazy, because I don't want to do things. It's because, you know, sometimes my fear is so intense, you know, I'm just almost afraid to start working because the failure's there. You don't want to fail. But then I think it was only recently, I think only a year ago, that I bumped into one of my friends and I was having a talk to him, because he works in a studio, and he was saying, you know, man, there's two options. You know, you can stand still and never move forward, or you can take a chance and work and then possibly move, you know, forward. So, I mean, that's the only two options. And when I put it, you know, when I put it like that, you know, the two extremes, I was like, well, yeah, the only option, if I don't do anything, is basically just to stay where I am. And I don't want to do that. So,
true.
Yeah.
And why, I always wondered, like, when we were talking about this, I always had a question. What do you do when you quit? What do you do when you quit? Where do you go when you quit? You
know, yeah.
Literally, that's my question always. Like, what the fuck do people do which quit?
Yeah.
I never quit. I always say, on the shield or with it, as the Spartans say when they're going to the war. You are coming with the shield, or they're bringing you only the dead. That's my saying. I love it, you know.
Yeah.
And I always ask, what do you do when you quit? Where do you go, you know? I don't know even where do I go if I quit.
Yeah.
Because I don't see any other option.
Yeah.
And people are different.
Yeah.
People are very different, and that's what I love about people, because everybody is so, so different, and that's a great thing.
Yeah.
And everybody has a different approach to life.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that my approach is the best. It doesn't mean that other person is best. And we definitely are so much different that there are different approaches to anything. So, yeah, everything goes in a different way and different direction.
Yeah. I mean, definitely that was one of the things that, you know, people talked to me about as well, is that, well, what is the alternative? I mean, the alternative is going and working in a supermarket, or like a dead end kind of crappy job where you don't get to be creative, and then that was what kind of lit the fire under my ass, and I says, well, you know, I don't want to go back to that. I don't want to have to, you know, go, because I have spoke to people in the past who have got degrees from art colleges or art universities, and a couple of guys in particular I know who have got really prestigious degrees, and they're literally working in a supermarket packing shelves. And
that's a horrible way to die. That's a horrible way to die, literally. People, that's one of the things, I don't like titles. I never mentioned that on my Facebook or anything, but I don't like titles. I have them many, but I don't like them, because people then feel entitled, like they need to have something if they finish, you know. I finished that prestigious university and everything. I got so many awards and stuff like that. But I don't like when I'm called sir or stuff like that, because I'm not a sir.
Yeah.
I'm Darko at the end of the day, and I'm not entitled to anything. Get my awards, they are in the past.
Yeah.
And I see a lot of people, you know, hanging on to them. I did this, I did that, I did this. Man, what did you do yesterday?
Yeah.
What was your day? Well, when you start doing more of today, we can talk, because from yesterday, your achievements, they're in the shelf. They're in the shelf. Maybe you can show them off to girls and pretend that you're cool, but you need to evolve all the time. That's how I see it.
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, I think it's the people who are a bit more humble about their work that that go further in this industry. Like, I mean, I was actually reading, you know, funny enough, you know, because I've got you on Facebook. I was looking at your story about the guy that came into the bar and was an artist, and
Yeah, one of the best nights of my life. What?
yeah, because I mean, like, I read the whole thing, and I was kind of like, you know, I mean, it's different if you know, because obviously I know people who are fine artists, and you know their stuff is great, and you know, but then they are again, it's the humble factor. It's the fact that you know, even though you know one of my friends is a very accomplished painter and does you know oil canvases and stuff and amazing stuff, and
Awesome.
yeah, and then you're like, oh, that's great, but then if you spoke to her, she would be like, no, I mean, my stuff's terrible. It could be so much better. But then the guy, I think he was kind of just full of himself. Yeah, I mean, he basically was just showing off.
Man, he was like a talking machine. You know, but he was funny. You know, I love when I meet the kind of people because I like to see what's in their head because I'm trying to understand them, and sometimes I can't understand them. You know, I don't know that humble thing. A lot of artists are talking about that. You need to be humble. You need to be this. You need to be that. But I have a different thinking about that. You don't need to be humble. You can be whatever you want. Because as we said, everybody's different. Some people are fake humble, some people are too much humble without the reason and stuff like that. But my experience that you need to be very harsh to yourself, as I said. I mean, okay, I took the Artstation award, but what about after that? What do you do after that? What? I'm gonna go and talk for next 10 years that I won Artstation? No, that's not gonna happen. That's very lame if I go and continue talking about that. I mean, it's a great promotion and everything. But setting new goals, because I met some people who won some really big competition, and they are picking the fruit from it for next 15 years, and their work is standing in the place, and like it's the same like 15 years ago, and they are still, oh, I want that competition, I want that. Okay, cool, but let's evolve a little bit. Let's move somewhere else.
I mean, it's like people who run a marathon once in their life and then talk about it forever. Like, you know, like the like I'll run a 10K. Like, oh, that's great. What, just recently? No, like 10 years ago. All oh, right, cool. Okay. Like
You know,
a great accomplishment at the time, but then, you know, to be using it forever.
because we Serbians, we do a lot of sports and stuff like that, and we have a lot of sport people here, and they every time when they don't succeed, they are talking about their accomplishments like 15 years ago. Oh, if I continued, I would do this, I would do that. If I continued, you know, and you're like, but you didn't. You didn't. Why? Because you were too lazy. You were too lazy to continue, and you maybe you were an asshole, maybe you were full of yourself. I don't know that, but I know you were lazy. If you were that good, everybody can have a good idea. Everybody could have a good day, but not everybody can do it consistently. Wake up, grind in pain. Wake up, grind in pain. Wake up, grind in pain, because it's painful. It's very painful. Sportsman life is especially painful. You know, everybody sees only the side where they are buying champagnes and stuff like that, but they don't see that they are working 6 times a day. And so sports life, I'm a sportsman of myself. I love sports and I do everything in that way. You have to be very dedicated if you want to be good at it. And
Definitely.
I approach art the same way, with pure passion. And I know I'm gonna be in pain, but as I love that movie, by the way, that I'm gonna mention, as they said in the movie, a moment of pain is nothing compared to a lifetime of greatness.
Yeah, totally. And I mean, it was it's like you know, I've watched, you know, several kind of sports documentaries, but like one of my, you know, my favorites is Arnold Schwarzenegger's Pumping Iron, which he done back in like the 70s. And you know, he's talked about, you know, oh yeah, you go to the gym and you lift till like you fall over and you hurt, but then you grow, you know, your muscles grow. They grow because they hurt. They grow because you're stretching them and you're making them bigger. And it's that mentality can be applied to, you know, his entire life and everybody else's. I mean, the guy's had an illustrious movie career, a modeling career. He was Mr. Universe, Mr. Olympia, and then obviously he was the governor of California. You know, like, I mean,
He's awesome.
yeah, because he's had this whole mentality basically of
Him
just,
and Sly. I love Sly. I love
oh
Stallone and him. They are great. They are typical workers, you know, that work their ass off. And I love him. I mean, I always love Rocky. I mention him a lot, and also Schwarzenegger. They are great. They are great.
Oh yeah, I mean, like, I'm a huge, you know, Sly and Arnie from back in the day, but yeah, they are exactly two people who have that work ethic that they've just, you know, they never give up. They've always pushed themselves to do better. They've always pushed themselves to do more. Especially, you know, Arnold and Sylvester, they've both came from a background where they didn't have a lot of advantages. You know, their family weren't rich, didn't have a lot of money, but they worked really hard to make sure that they got, you know, where they got to. And Arnold especially, because obviously Sylvester, you know, was getting into acting, but he was a bodybuilder for years, and you know, that's in itself is a very competitive sport. It's very hard to maintain, to be very good at it. And but it was the stuff he was doing beyond the normal competitors. Like, I remember in the film, he was going to I think it was a ballerina class at the time, but then she was showing him how to basically, like, you know, like, you know, how to stand, how to present himself, how to point his arms, and how to look more graceful. And the stuff like that was the extra mile he was going to make sure that he was above everybody else. And it was something that, no other athlete, they were just going to the gym, they were just lifting.
Of course.
But he knew how to present himself.
When you love something, you have to do something that you don't love. Literally, that you don't love, because every field has multiple fields in it.
Yeah.
And it's never a single field, and people get lost there when they're doing that, from my experience. Yeah. A lot of people get lost, that they are always thinking, okay, I'm a painter, and that's it. You're not only a painter. You need to learn a lot of stuff, because everything you learn, it can improve. It can improve your basic. I mean, I started in a 3D, and thankfully to 3D, I started feeling the shapes and forms much better than the people that did only 2D for all their life, you know?
Yeah, totally.
And everybody was telling me, why are you doing 3D? Because 3D one then wasn't so applied. And I was like, well, it helps me feel the forms and shapes more.
Yeah.
And eventually everybody is now in 3D. But yeah, I was going extra mile. Or I remember when I was in a university, we had a fashion design.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, Darko, you don't like fashion design, you don't fit in here, because everybody on fashion design was like, I'm the best, I'm the best designer, and it wasn't my thing. I was like, okay, I'm a manly man. and I was going there, and just a second, sorry. And I was going there, and I was like, okay, let's go here. And after a while, I started liking it, because I was learning a lot about textures and stuff like that. And you can see that in my work when I work in textures on 3D, because I was so much paying attention to the textures and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And but other guys didn't want to go. They didn't want to. They didn't care. They were like, oh, I'm not going to do this. This is not my field. I'm not doing it. Well, try it. Maybe you will like it, you know.
Yeah. But then there's so much potential, I think, now to experiment with art in a way that it isn't as intimidating. I mean, I know people who even try to approach Photoshop initially think that it's so intimidating to use, but then, you know, there's stuff like, you know, there's just drawing and design apps on like iPads and stuff that you can get into that, you know, are less of a barrier. And that actually is a good transition to talk about our sponsor. which is Procreate. So guys, we'll take a minute just to thank our sponsor on Digital Artcast, which is Procreate. If you guys don't know, Procreate's an Apple Design Award-winning digital painting and illustration app that's designed exclusively for iOS. It allows you to create professional-grade artworks wherever you are. With an advanced gel texture brush engine, they just introduced wet brushes in the new Procreate 4. The layering system, obviously, groundbreaking canvas resolutions, which I think go up now to about 16K, which I think you only get 5 layers with, but at that resolution, you're really pushing the pixels anyway. And it's all for $9.99. You can find it through the App Store, or of course you can go to procreate.art. The whole reason I partnered back with Procreate back in the day, I think, because before I even got any painting, I was using the app, just on my iPad that I had at the time. I think it was a normal iPad and a basic stylus, but it was a good introduction into like layering, clipping masks, color theory, you know, stuff like that. So. Yeah, have you had much experience with Procreate? You ever used it, or?
I have never used it, but I would like. I'm seeing some stuff. It's amazing. I saw that Anthony Jones now is using it. A lot of artists, but latest that I saw like 2 days ago, he is doing it, and it looks very fun. It looks very fun. I know that Nikola Matković.
He's
working. We were sitting a couple of days ago. He was in Belgrade here, and we were talking. He's working on it, and he was like, man, it's so awesome. It's also portable. I love it. And I was like, man, I need to try that. But
yeah.
I tried Apple Pen, like, I think it was 2 years ago, right, in Brussels, Belgium.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, this pen is really, really good. I can't wait to see what they do with it.
I mean, it's definitely been one of the first, you know, ways I saw it being a professional tool was when I went to industry workshops and I talked to Nikolai Lockerstein, and he was... Uh-huh. Yeah, he uses Procreate exclusively, and he was showing me just the last initial workshops I went to. He was showing me some stuff he was doing for a film, and super grainy, super dark, super realistic. You know, no photo bashing, just pure painting, but all through Procreate, and it was. And obviously, I think since iPad Pro and the Apple Pencils came out, it's been kind of Christmas for him because he was using it way back when it was, you know, it was just a stylus and the original iPad, but. But yeah, he talks about it constantly, and it's a great app. You know, I love it. I think it's going to be definitely a shift in the industry where you'll see more people working professionally in it, as opposed to stuff like Photoshop and 3D programs. It's a great
app. So much new stuff. Industry is exploding, and like not only Procreate, but a lot of stuff is happening. It's crazy how much industry is. You don't have time to try everything.
Man, too many programs.
I'm one of those guys that is like, I want to try everything, this, but there is no time anymore.
Yeah.
When I started, there was Maya only, you know, 3D Studio Max, Maya, and Softimage.
Yeah.
And that was it. Now everything was so much different. Now literally everything's on the reach of your hand and for a very good price.
There's so much stuff, and Procreate's, I think, one of the guys that are leading design wise to kind of push the barrier. So thanks to Procreate for sponsoring us.
Thank you, Procreate.
Yes, we appreciate it. So you're talking about with 3D programs. I've noticed that you're using stuff like ZBrush and Keyshot. I mean, personally, I'm using Maya at the moment and stuff like either V-Ray or Arnold. So are you, with your process, Darko, specifically, because I think it's one where there's a new generation of people designing stuff, with a lot of your drawing skills, did you push your drawing skills, or have you used 3D as a way to enhance the form first and then draw over? How do you kind of approach a piece when you make it?
Well, it depends from a project to project, but mostly... There, I will go with the pros and cons with both, from my experience. When I'm doing a 2D, sketch, it gets much better because I'm much more loose and I'm not thinking that much, and I get much better shapes that are unique and stuff like that. But I lose the 3D in it. So if I want to translate it to 3D, there is going to be some mistake. And that happens a lot in car design, you know, because in car design, you work for months in 2D, then you move to 3D, 3D modeling first. Yeah. Then you are like, what the fuck was I doing here for 6 months? How I didn't see this? It's not working. This is not the same car as in the sketch. And then you move from 3D to clay, and you're again, what the fuck was I doing? So yeah, that's the con of it. You know, you're losing 3D, but you get much, your personality comes out, your energy comes out on the paper.
Yeah.
So when you're doing 2D, and when you're doing 3D, you get much more stiff. You get much more stiff, and a lot of times you can get the unique shape that you can get from a 2D, even though you're painting. Over the 3D, but you become stiff because of the object. But the good thing is that it's going to be exactly the same in 3D when you move, and it's going to be much easier. Yeah. So I try to work from different sides and approach different sides of the project. Mm-hmm. I start with the initial sketches that are in 2D, very loose, very, very loose, until I get something nice.
Yeah.
And then I move, depends again from a project. When I'm doing guns, and smaller stuff like that, which are more boxy, I do them in Fusion 360 or in Maya immediately when I'm blocking them out in a 3D model.
Right.
So because they are much easier to model, and they need the precision. They need a specific precision that the ZBrush can give me, but takes me much more time because I'm so used to Maya.
Right, yeah.
When I'm doing something more organic, I go in ZBrush immediately and I box it out.
Yeah.
But I tend to sketch for at least, if I'm doing some serious project for 5 days, because I go from initial sketch to drawing to everything, to exploration, and then I move to 3D, and then I block it out, then I see what's not working, come back again, and yeah, that's it pretty much.
Yeah, I mean, like, it sounds like a process is usually very similar to mine's, and I think it's the way that you can now use multiple tools to basically get an end result, where it used to be that, you know, you'd maybe do some sketching and then go to Photoshop, and but then there's so many options now that you know, even with Keyshot and stuff like that, you know, and I've obviously seen Anthony Jones and Mache and a couple of the guys like Ashthorpe using stuff like ZBrush and then jumping into Keyshot, putting a basic material on and then rendering. And it's such a quick process now. I mean, like, even Anthony Jones shared a thing last night where you can now brush in a shape in Photoshop and then use a 3D perspective tool and it builds 3D objects for you, like instantly, just using a brush. And I was like, holy shit. Like, I mean, it's getting to a point now where even with 3D modeling, it's becoming so much easier just to make something so simple and so quick. Whereas before, even before Dynamesh, you know, ZBrush was used, but it was no as tangible as it is now.
ZBrush is insane. It's insane. Like, literally insane,
Crazy.
you
I've
know?
been told, especially for 2D artists who sketch a lot, it is more natural to work in it than most programs that require more, like you said, the block thinking mentality, like Maya and Fusion.
Yeah, I was in the middle of it all, you know, when it was happening, when it was the 3D was having a boom, and it was having a boom in the car design and every other design. Everybody was doing 3D, 3D or only. And I remember a professor coming to university. He was an older guy and he was 2D only. And he said the problem that industry has now is that we are all getting sexy, super nice images with a bad design.
And I think that's what I was going to touch on, was that, you know, one of my heroes, and, you know, I was lucky enough to meet him, but, you know, Scott Robertson was a big influence on a lot of people, and he obviously started in car
He
industrial
is
design.
awesome. He is awesome.
Yeah. But then I think, like you said, with industrial design, I think that's almost what games and movies are becoming. It is a way of industrial design because, you know, you're making these things that are then going to be implemented into movies and games, and they have a design purpose. Like, a gun has to fire a certain way, it has to have mechanics, a piece of armor has to open and shut a certain way because of real life, you know, engineering. So I think industrial design is a very good grounding for what you come into the industry. I mean, do you feel the same? Do you feel like it's been a positive in your design process?
Well, definitely it was, and it is still, you know, because industrial design, yeah, we are becoming industrial designers. It's not anymore only a sketch. We are moving into making stuff and stuff like that, you know. And video games are evolving quite a lot in that aspect, you know. Before games, when you look at it, you are like, mostly, how the hell is this working? Most of the stuff. But now it has evolved so much that it's becoming a functional object, a really functional object. You look at the new games, they are like, you can print it out of the game and you're getting something that is functional.
Yeah, 100%. And obviously, like, you'll find that with vehicles as well, that, you know, the stuff that you, I mean, like the Earth Giant that, you know, you designed for the Artstation competition, you know, I could see that, like, obviously not in maybe modern times, but, you know, 20 years from now, that is something that, you know, the construction industry could be using. It's something that they could be, you know, utilizing. And it's that practical effect that, you know, I think when you can see the real world application, it makes it more believable for people when they then play it in a game or see it in a game or in a movie. They're like, you know, I understand that. I can see where that can be used. It's almost like the uncanny valley effect, where if something's too removed, you know, you couldn't really see the practical application. Like, even your butterfly armor that you've done for your book,
Thank you.
you could totally see, like, oh, that could be used, you know, in, you know, 20 years, probably 10 years, but in the military.
Tomorrow.
Totally. I mean, like, it's probably technology that, you know, they have worked on or are working on, but it's very of that way that you can see the real world application. Like, oh, I can understand where that works from, which is great as well. I think that you implemented with the butterfly armor, you actually done something that a lot of industrial designers have done for years, which is you draw from nature. You know, you take something that exists in nature and then take an industrial spin on it. How did you come up with that initial idea? Was that something that you kind of worked on for a while, or?
The specific armor, I had it for a while in my head, but I didn't work for a while on it. And I had some basic sketches that I never posted, but maybe I should post them. And then I moved to a photo bash. It was a photo bash. I will tell you honestly, I'm not a big fan of photo bash. I can do it, but I'm not a big fan. And it's strange how much the industry has prospered because of it, and it's gone backwards, as we talked. A lot of design looks the same. I mean, there are some masters that can do some crazy stuff with Photobash, but I'm always trying to avoid it. And I try to have it 25% in my work, you know. That's my idea. But yeah, it was a sketch in my head, and then I moved in a photo bash and I designed it. Because I read a lot. I really read a lot how stuff function and how this can work and why it can work and why it cannot work.
Right.
And a lot of designers are not doing that today. I don't know why, but a lot of when you go to Artstation, a lot of designs, you don't understand why they are designed like that. They are just a cool shape. They are just a cool shape, and that's it pretty much. Yeah. So I'm trying to steer away from that, you know.
Yeah, because you want to have function as well as form. Like, you need it to, you know, look pretty, but at the same time, it has to work. You know what I mean? So
yeah, man, it's quite strange. You know, when you are in I was industrial design, there form follows function all the time. All the time. And then you move to car design, and there is only form. Like, because function is so stuck, you're like, only form, only form. I don't care. Engineer is going to fix this. And it's quite strange.
Yeah, and I think that's... Because, I mean, going back to my roots, when initially I started learning about concept art and people were talking about it, and people talk about how concept art is problem solving. So you're always solving a problem, you know, like, you know, we need a weapon. Like, okay, right, well, I'll invent one in my head and then put it on paper. Okay, so how does the weapon function? I'll be able to then, you know, there's this bow functions because it has this special string or this wood, or, you know, you pull back and then release. And, you know, it's simple stuff like that that you need to, you know, people think, for a lot of times, especially in concept art for games and stuff like that people think that you draw a lot of pretty pictures, like, you know, sunsets and mountains, and, you know, and that, I mean, that side of it does exist, that, you know, those things are there, but a lot of the initial concept is basically solving loads of problems, like, what does this world look like, how do the vehicles work in it, why do people carry certain weapons and how do they function, what energy powers their guns, you know, how do they reload, what kind of buildings exist after the war, and how were they structured, you know, did they build them from parts that existed after the war, and where did they get those parts, what materials are they made of, what colour are they, how do they form, like, it's things like that that people don't think about when they go into the industry. They think that they will just, you know, make
just
a cool...
Just pretty stuff,
yeah. Yeah, pretty much. Like, you know, people may maybe draw a cool building, you know, in a funky shape that resembles a plant or something. But then a designer might come in at a point where they're trying to build something more grounded and say, well, that's a cool-looking building, but how the fuck did people build that? Like, you know, how would they have constructed... Where would they have got the materials? Like, how would you make glass that shape? And people would just say, oh, you know, I just made it because it looked cool. And you're like, yeah, that's fine. Yeah. But at the same time, you have to think how people will approach this in real life. And again, I think that even, you know, people would say, oh, no, yeah, but there's a fantasy setting where people, things can exist without a reality. And I'm like, well, I understand that, but there's even some high fantasy scenarios where people still have to have function. Like, it still has to, you know, swords look like swords and they're weighted properly because, you know, they swing. And then when you come to castles, they're constructed, you know, in the most realistic sense that how castles would be constructed with mortar and stone and, you know, and cement. But... you know, it's a thing that I think has to be applied through everything you design. And although your stuff, you know, like your butterfly armor might seem like science fiction to people, there is a practical use there that could be applied to real world materials to make that thing. So
thanks, man. Yeah, I'm reading a lot. I read a lot before anything. I try to leave the project as much as I can because that's the only way to make it work.
Yeah.
And I try to leave it. To literally leave it and to see how it can work, how it can function, why it can function. And I do a lot of, you know, the shitty sketches, I call them like that, you know, when they're ugly as hell, but they're doing their job because I'm figuring it out how it works. And then I move to more beautiful ones. But before that, I'm not trying. And a lot of people, when they see how I work, they're a lot of time, they're like, well, you're not drawing that much. I am drawing, but I'm drawing in my head how it's going to function. Then when I have what I'm going to do, it's much easier and faster to get there.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that's a process that people like to see. They like to see the initial ideas, but, you know, there's some people I know who work, I mean, it's this thing where everybody has their own way of working, you know. I mean, I know people who say, oh, well, you need to maybe go through, like, you know, I don't know, 7 or 8 iterations of something before you get to the final thing in your head, and that's fine for some people, but I know a very successful concept artist, Paul Scott Canavan, who... is based over here in the UK and in Scotland, and he said that one of his processes is that he usually just goes straight to the final idea. Like, he gets a base couple of thumbnails, but then he more or less has, like, right, that's the final idea, bang, and then works straight into it. And that's...
Yeah, we met on IFCC. He's a great guy. He also does amazing work. We met.
Yeah, totally. The guy's a legend. And he's just...
Yeah, when you have crystallized what you're going to do, it's much easier than when you're doing it random, because, you know, For example, when I was doing Spirit, or when I was, let's do Earth Giant, when I was doing Earth Giant and I approached industrial design, like completely industrial design, like, and I was like, okay, so the subject is epic, as I remember, it was an epic.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, what is epic? And then I started analyzing, and then I was like, okay, I want it to be big, I want it to be powerful. I had like 30 words, keywords that it's going to represent. I had mood boards, I had everything, and it took me like, I think 7 days to complete everything that. And everybody was posting already on the Artstation. They were posting initial sketches, everything. And I wasn't even on the map.
Right.
I didn't have anything. And when I was ready, I said, okay, I want to do this. And I printed it. I put it beside me so I can look at it every time when I'm going from a face to face. So I know I'm going in a direction.
Right.
And then I started working on it. That's how I approach it, you know.
Wow, yeah. And I mean, that's definitely a more direct way of working than, you know, people would say that, you know, you need to do a million sketches first and do color theory and, you know, think about this and that. And I mean, I think if you're educated enough that you know these things, kind of like maybe not even second nature, but, you know, you have enough grounding that you can approach that stuff. You don't have to sketch everything out. You don't have to work on colours for ages. You know, if you know, well, it should have warm tones, it should be this or that, then you can kind of go straight to the end result, which I think is probably, especially in this industry, better, because then it's less time wasted. You know what I mean? So.
Yeah, true. Well, you know how it goes. When you are good at something, mostly you drew it already so many times that you analyzed everything and you know how it works. Character, vehicle, environment, doesn't matter, and you feel relaxed there.
Yeah.
Why don't we bring that kind of approach to any other project? So I'm gonna feel relaxed if I know more about it. If
yeah.
I investigate more, I'm gonna feel more relaxed, and it's gonna go easier, you know.
Yeah, definitely, 100%. Yeah, definitely. Cool. Okay. So I mean, like, yeah, talking about, you know, kind of future and moving forward as an artist in general. You're obviously working on some projects just now. You have these things, obviously, you can't talk about, but. What is your kind of plan moving forward? Do you have like an end goal? Are you looking to work in a studio at one point? Are you looking to take on more work, or, you know, pursue or teach or lecture? I mean, what's kind of the future for you moving forward?
Oof, hard question.
Yeah,
hard
definitely.
Question. I have it in my head, but it always changes because
yeah.
I have to be very flexible. What happens, you know?
Yeah.
But my I would like mm-hmm. to work on a Marvel movie.
Oh, wow.
I would really like to work on a Marvel movie and to design some stuff for them. That would be my, like, dream.
Right, cool.
Yeah, but I want to stay here at the moment and I don't want to move.
Right.
That's one of the things that I would like to, how much possible it is, I don't know.
Right.
And at the moment, the end project and end of this part of the life, I don't know until when I finish it, is the book.
Right.
So
okay.
I'm putting a lot of effort in it. I would cry if it doesn't go good. so yeah, that's the end effort of this part of the life, and then we will see where I move later. I don't know where it's gonna take me, but I would like to work for Marvel, you know, because they're at the moment kicking some ass, and I'm like drawing over their stuff, and I'm like, oh, this is so cool, so cool.
Yeah.
They're great.
I mean, it's still an impossible dream, at least. I mean, I know plenty of people who work on the Marvel franchises, and then, yeah, they just started by doing basic concept work and then just got the call to work on the films. So, I mean, it's no impossible. It can happen. So yeah.
Well, anything can happen. We shall see.
Yeah.
We shall see where it goes. But, yeah, that's the idea, you know. And the book, I wanted to do the best and then see what happens. Maybe try to push it in some direction as Dan Luisi did. Or maybe a game, maybe a movie, who knows where it can go. We shall see. It's a really big universe. It's a huge universe, I will be honest. It started from a vehicles. Now it has 14 characters, 7 weapons. I don't know what it doesn't have. So, yeah, that's what I would like. We should see.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. And I think, obviously, the strides you've took so far have been impressive enough. So at the continued rate you're going, things can only get better. So, I mean, it's not like you're going to regress or go backwards, you know, you're only going to go forward. So, I mean,
thanks, man.
Yeah, I mean, 100%. I can only hope myself to do good things as well. And, you know, I mean, it's initially obviously starting, because my biggest fear at the moment was when I finished university, what was I going to do next? And I was lucky that Nick gave me an arm and obviously gave me an opportunity to work on their games. So That's been great just now. So, but yeah, it's inspired me to work harder, because now that I've got that initial push to work in the industry on this indie game, I'm just wanting to try and make my aims higher. So, yeah, it's definitely given me a boost anyway in morale and just a general feeling of accomplishment. So that's helped me with mentality going forward. So yeah,
that's good to hear.
Yeah, man.
Keep on rocking.
Yeah, definitely. And obviously, congrats to you as well, because obviously, you know, you can't talk about it, but you know, you're working on stuff. So, I think that's always the greatest payoff, is when you think that, you know, you're grinding away and you're making things and you're waiting for that. No, the phone call now, it's the email. But you know, when you got that first email, you must have been like, oh yeah, you know, fantastic. This is what I've been waiting for.
Man, you won't believe how happy I was when I got the call. You won't believe how happy. One job I got by accident, literally by accident over Facebook. I was like, hey, I'm that and that. Do you need some work, you know, from me? Literally, it was literally like that, like, because I knew who they were.
Right.
And I was like, do you need some work? Uh-huh. I want to work on the movies and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And they were like, oh, perfect. We have something. And they literally immediately the same night.
Yeah.
Immediately the same night, they sent me the files and they were like, okay, you have 2 days to finish this. And I was like, okay.
No sleep.
Yeah, it was, and I would like to thank them for that, because it was the first job for me, so yeah.
Yeah,
I can't mention them still, hopefully soon I will be able, but yeah.
Yeah, definitely, man, it's good progress, it's impressive, man, it's awesome. Cool, okay, well, we'll come to an end there, so people don't get too bored. Obviously, I think an hour is a sweet spot, but yeah, so I mean, if people want to get in touch or want to get, you know, check out your work, where can they find you, where can they see your stuff?
You can see my stuff on Artstation, artofdarmar.com. That's my website and Artstation profile. They are connected. Mm-hmm. Or they can find me on Instagram, artof, how do you say, the line when it's down. What's the name? Tilde, right? Is it tilde? No. Artofdarmar. They can find me on Instagram.
Right.
And they have me on Facebook, Darko Markovic Darmar. Mm-hmm. If they want to see, if they need some help or anything, they can hit me a message. I always reply to anybody, mostly anybody.
Yep. But
sometimes I get some horrible questions and I'm like, I can't answer this. But if they need any help, they can hit me up whenever they want. I'm responding to anything and try to help everybody, because I knew how it was for me when I was new. Nobody was there. So
whenever
they need something, they can hit me up.
Yeah, I think with things like IFCC and Initial Workshops and Trojan Horse, it's good that we know there's this kind of family community spirit that we all kind of harbour and help everybody out as much as we can, because we've all been there, we've all been starting, so I totally understand. And all, final question would be, when's the book coming out? Do you know yet?
Hopefully, in next year it should come out. Hopefully, I should bring it. We are talking about the IFCC and stuff like that. And I want to say hello to Marco, because we became really good over time.
Yeah,
he's a great
awesome.
Time. Yeah, he's awesome. I hate him sometimes, but he's awesome. I like to say hello to him.
Yeah.
And hopefully, I will have the book on the IFCC or 2 months after it. That's my plan.
Right.
If I don't spread the story more, because it's already huge and I can't go over 300 pages.
Right, okay.
And I'm already on a lot of pages. I don't know how that happened, but when I finish the characters, I'm starting, as I talked with Spirit on everything, we should start to agree how where to move, because probably he's gonna publish the book.
Right.
If he gives a good price. Did you hear, Spiridon? We need a good price.
Yeah. Do my solids.
So, that's it pretty much.
Yeah, awesome. Okay, man. Great. Well, it's been great talking to you. Thank you for coming
here.
On. Yeah, and sparing your time. I know there was initial bumps in the road, but we got there eventually. So, and yeah, man, it'll be great. For everybody else, check out Darko's work. Obviously, it's awesome.
Thank you,
stay tuned. If you guys want to leave a comment and a like down below in the comment section, usually through YouTube, or leave us even a review on iTunes, wherever you listen to us, I'll pick a name at random, whoever responds, and you'll get a free copy of Procreate, which we do every time we have an interview. We get free codes from Procreate to so you guys can get a taste of the app. And at the moment, you know, not a lot of people are responding. We're getting a couple hundred views per video, but nobody's really putting a comment down below. But if you're the lucky one that does, you'll get a free copy of Porky, which is worth a whole £10, so don't be stupid. Respond, for God's sake.
For free, people.
yeah, you're saving a whole £10, so yeah. Plus you're getting an awesome piece of software. So yeah, man, so yeah, thanks again, and yeah, we'll talk later. Okay, thanks guys, bye.
Thanks guys, bye.